And welcome to our first day of Illuminate sessions with the Amsterdam University of Applied Sciences. We're delighted to welcome them to Winnipeg. There's a couple more that'll be walking in a couple of minutes. They're just grabbing some coffee. Anyway, it's really a pleasure to welcome the group here. They arrived Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and they're delighted already with Winnipeg. So, as you've seen in your program book, we have three themes for the collaboration, and today's theme is interprofessional collaboration. And I'm delighted to introduce our guests. We'll start with our guests as our preliminary presenters, and then we'll turn it over to our local presenters, which are Moni Fricke, who's beside me, and Lisa Mendez. So our first presenter is Stephan
Ramaekers. I think we've changed the order, or is Stephan going first?
I'm sorry, but
set up this way.
Okay.
I think we've been told that just in the last few minutes okay. that U of M is going to go first to give them a chance to settle down.
Okay.
Settle in.
Okay, there we go. So that's why you're standing.
That's why I'm standing beside you.
Okay. So Moni Fricke is in the Department of Physical Therapy and holds a variety of educational and administrative roles. And she is the director of the Office of Interprofessional Collaboration. Anything you want to add to that?
That's good.
Okay. And Lisa Mendez is an instructor in the Department of Occupational Therapy and is also appointed as the Interprofessional Coordinator with the Rady Faculty of Health Sciences. So we'll start with you two and then we'll move on to, and I'll introduce the our guest from Australia.
Perfect.
From Amsterdam, sorry.
And I have a mic, my own mic over here somewhere. There it is.
So, good morning. Yes, there was a very impromptu, spontaneous change of order of presenters, so that was, sorry for the confusion. Before we start, I just want to acknowledge the traditional lands that we're standing on, the homeland of the Métis people, the Dakota, Dene, Ojai Cree, get them all in the right, they're a different order than it's usually listed, Anishinaabeg, and who did I leave out? I left somebody out. Pardon me, did I leave out? Cree. I think I said Cree. Did I? Okay. I acknowledge the land that we're standing on, where a Treaty 1 land was signed, and that the University of Manitoba, and I think all of us in this room, we acknowledge the wrongs that were committed in the past and that continue today, and we all try to, for ourselves, try to figure out how we can work towards reconciliation within our own country. And as our guests are here, just to familiarize you with the way we try to do things at University of Manitoba and many of the Canadian institutions across the country now is acknowledging the wrongs that we have committed in the past as immigrants, as settlers within this country. And so acknowledging that, and we try to make sure that we can role model as best as we can how we can move forward towards reconciliation. So, the work that I'm going to talk about is the work that's been done on behalf of the Office of Interprofessional Collaboration at the University of Manitoba. It's built on a long-standing history of interprofessional activities where we've taken groups of students in different pockets of clinical practice opportunities as well as in the classroom. And what I'm presenting on today is not just, by no means is it my work alone. I'm just the one who's presenting on behalf of the group. There are a host of people who've developed the curriculum to where we are today. But in 15 minutes, trying to talk about where we're at with our curriculum from on behalf of the Office of Interprofessional Collaboration. But I think I should also mention that while I'm speaking on behalf of the office, this is not meant to discount all the other activities that are being done by the College of Rehab Sciences in addition to the activities that are delivered by the Office of Interprofessional Collaboration. And in our meetings this afternoon, we'll talk about some of the other activities that we're doing as well, but we're taking this opportunity just to talk about what the office is doing at a faculty-wide level. So we do know that, and many of you have seen these slides before in a variety of settings, but we do know that the World Health Organization certainly started promoting interprofessional education and collaborative approaches for patient-centered care at least in 2010, if not before. And that really, when we're talking about interprofessional collaboration, we do feel strongly, also from the evidence from the Institute of Health Improvement in the US, that if we work together, we can improve patient satisfaction, improve provider satisfaction, provide better care, and more efficiencies in the system. This is really essentially why we're putting all these efforts and resources into trying to get teams to work better together. At the university, we're trying to get that process started early by providing opportunities for interprofessional education very early on, before learners get set up in their silos and their own uniprofessional approaches. There is a growing body of evidence to support that this it's better to happen earlier before these silos get set up. And when we're talking about interprofessional education, while we're talking in this curriculum, we have 9 professions working together. Really, interprofessional education opportunities happen wherever you have 2 or more professionals in a setting together where they have the opportunity not just to sit beside one another, but to learn about each other, from each other, and with each other on a variety of interactive sorts of topics. What we've done in a nutshell at the University of Manitoba, which has begun in 2016, so we are now in our beginning our 4th iteration of a longitudinal curriculum trying to establish a framework and the groundwork around interprofessional collaboration. We have more than 600 students every fall beginning in this curriculum, so at any one time 1,200 students at once across 9 different professions. The professions that are included are from medicine, the physician assistant program, occupational therapy, respiratory therapy, physiotherapy, that's 5, pharmacy, 6, nursing, 7, dentistry, and dental hygiene, that makes 9. So trying to get everybody together has been a huge challenge. We've been very fortunate by getting central administrative support, by reserving time in the curriculum to actually allow our students to come together in a face-to-face event once per term over a 2-year period. So we've created interprofessional teams of students who are learning about common themes while learning about collaborative practice over a 2-year time period. So this is our map. Term 1, term 2, and the 2 major column headings at the top, and then year 1 and year 2. In year 1, we start off with a focus on population health. It's basically determinants of health, something that all the different professionals learn in their own programs, but we do it from a collaborative perspective. How can we work best together? And in year 2, the focus is on patient safety. So I said that there's 4 face-to-face events essentially over the 2-year period, and we've taken Bloom's taxonomy and tried to integrate it from a curriculum, from a continuum, if you will, of learning. So in year 1, the first face-to-face, they do visits into the community, here in this neighborhood primarily. In the 2nd term, a case study. In the 3rd term, the beginning of year 2, they use simulation to assess a patient together. And then in the 4th face-to-face, they continue working on the same simulation case. The case just has some surprises as it unfolds. But because we realize that 1 face-to-face event is not enough, we use a blended learning approach, and they also have online discussions asynchronously, in other words, not at the same time. So they are guided through a variety of questions with facilitators, and they have these online discussions together. And they're graded. Originally they weren't graded, but we found that they didn't participate unless it was for marks. So we'll talk more about that this afternoon around some of the challenges. For the first 3 terms, each individual does a written reflection about what they learned in this process, answering specific questions. And at the end, at the very end, there's a group project that they need to do together. So that's really, in a nutshell, how we've laid out our curriculum. That year 1, year leads into year 2. We do use the competency framework for collaboration that was developed in Canada, and we focus on 3 collaboration competencies in the first year, on team functioning, interprofessional communication, and community-centered care. They're intentional because the students are still just learning what they have to offer themselves in their new roles as healthcare professionals. So to ask for an occupational therapy student to describe what they do in term 1, year 1, we think is probably not fair to them. Give them a little bit more time to develop that identity. Community-centered care is intentional. The collaboration competency is patient/client/family community-centered care. We know that all the programs do a great job at addressing individual needs and family needs. We wanted to take this up a notch and have an opportunity to work at a community level or population level. So very intentional. The other 3 competencies that we cover in year 2, role clarification, now that hopefully the student learners know what they actually have to offer, collaborative leadership, who's the right leader in the right place at the right time, and now hopefully there's some safety in their team and they know each other that we can start talking about conflict. And we do that intentionally again to make sure that they feel safe at this point to talk about what does conflict look like, how can it be healthy, and how can we manage it and resolve it interprofessionally. And so that's always a bit tricky to have those open and authentic conversations. And interwoven throughout this are interprofessional practice opportunities, which our colleague Lisa Mendez will speak about next. The theoretical foundations that we use, everything was intentional with a theoretical basis behind it. This is the National Competency Framework for Collaboration that we use that most people are familiar with. The quadruple aim of the Institute of Health Improvement from the US around better care, more satisfied patients, more satisfied providers, and lower total medical costs is part of the foundation of why we're doing this. When we have the individual students do their personal reflections, we use the Driscoll's model of reflection, the what, so what, now what, to try to unpack, to try and understand what they're experiencing and what the potential outcome might be on patient care. This is the population health model that we use. It's not very good resolution. That's produced by Hamilton and Batty. It was originally brought towards the on behalf of the Public Health Agency of Canada. And this model for health promotion at a population health level, it acknowledges the determinants of health, the Ottawa principles for health promotion, and the different levels where we might actually address health promotion, whether it's at individual or in the society level, et cetera. And then in the second year, when we focus on safety, we use the Canadian patient safety domains that are specific to Canada as well. There's lots of overlap in the domains around patient safety domains in needing good teamwork, a collaborative approach, being able to find the strength to let your voice be heard when there's potential patient safety issues. Program evaluation, we've written that, we've developed that from the outset right into the program. It is evolving as our own needs are evolving, but Kirkpatrick came up with a beautiful model around program evaluation, and Barr, who's from the UK, they adapted this for interprofessional education. So we are very intentional, again, how we're assessing as we go, learners' reactions, modification of attitudes and perceptions, how the students are acquiring knowledge and skills, change in behavior, change in organizational behavior and benefits to users. So some of these are done from a qualitative perspective, some are mixed methods, some of them are ongoing, and some are still emerging. So it is a process, but again, we're thinking very specifically how we can move this forward and evaluate over time. In the interest of time, just looking right ahead, lessons learned, we've had lots of lessons learned. It is an iterative curriculum. We are trying to change things as we get feedback from our facilitators, from our learners. That there's certainly, one of the interesting things actually in the first bullet is that we are starting to sense a difference in the impact of IPE based on the different programs that the students come from. I'd love to talk about that more, but in the interest of time, I can't. But we're exploring that very closely. We do know that early dialogue with all the stakeholders is crucial to make this happen, and we've been very fortunate here. The structures need to be in place to support authentic learner engagement. We hear over and over again from the learners, they want more face-to-face time, and they want it to be relevant and authentic to the clinical environment. Less is more. We probably started off with too much at the beginning. We're trying to scale it back a little bit. And active facilitation is key. Originally, we thought they could facilitate their own groups. No, they really do need a facilitator, which means more resources, which means more challenges. Never stop recruiting. That's what that comes from, because we're also starting to experience facilitator burnout. So how do we make sure we keep it fresh and gather more people? Reflect, 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 whether it's the learners, whether it's the facilitators, whether it's ourselves as a team who are delivering this, trying to learn from our mistakes and trying to embrace change as we move forward. There's a few references there. This is there. I don't think I have time for questions right now. I'm looking whoever is chairing this. Marlene?
Questions at the end?
At the end? Perfect. Okay. And you have your own thing.
Thank you, Moni. All right. So my name is Lisa Mendez, and I'm an occupational therapist, and for the last few years, I've been working as the Interprofessional Practice Coordinator with the Office of Interprofessional Collaboration. And so one of the privileges that I have in this role is creating interprofessional practice opportunities within communities, and specifically working with our Indigenous communities. And so I just to, I guess, situate myself with this. I am from a Eastern European background. I was raised on Treaty 2 territory, and now I'm privileged to call Treaty 1 territory my home. I work on Treaty 1, Treaty 5, and within Treaty 5 as well. And so the English name of the program that I coordinate is very pragmatic and descriptive. It is the two-week interprofessional learning experience in a rural or remote Indigenous community. And recently I was meeting with my colleagues in Gomez in Education, and Elder Margaret Lavallee asked me to tell her, what's this program called? And I sheepishly mumbled out all of those words. And she said to me, this program needs a better name. It needs a name that reflects the connections that your students are making with the communities, and it needs a name that reflects the relationships that are being built. So the name that she gave is Denewe Maganuk. And what this means is all my relations. And so I kind of took away very excited about this, but not really knowing a lot about what this meant, and so needing to kind of do my own reading and that kind of thing. And one of the things that I can really appreciate about Denewe Maganuk is, and this is all my relations in Anishinaabe, is really about how learning how we relate to ourselves and how we relate to others, and to really embrace kind of that relationship and how that can support health and well-being. And one of my favorite Indigenous authors is Thomas King, and he wrote that all my relations is an encouragement to for us to accept the responsibilities we have within the universal family by living our lives in a harmonious manner. And so just really wanting to ensure that as I'm creating this, I am now ensuring that the Denewe Maganuk is part of that. And so when I kind of step back and look at the University of Manitoba and the structures that support us, you know, how we are supporting this universal family can also be found in some of our documents. And so when we look at the strategic framework for the Rady Faculty of Health Sciences, I believe it's the fourth strategic framework, is really about how we can use interprofessional collaboration to improve care and improve care for all of our communities. And it specifically talks about enhancing our partnerships with our Indigenous communities to improve care. And the other component that the work that I do, I try to also align with our Reconciliation Action Plan. And there's three themes within that I feel the work can be linked to. So the one theme is around, this is the first theme about honoring indigenous knowledge. And so I do play a role in this as a non-Indigenous person in helping coordinate and establish the partnerships and help to ensure the students are ready to be good guests in communities, but it's really the knowledges of the community members that is key and important for the students to really learn about. The other theme is that is within our action plan. It relates to call 23 of our Truth and Reconciliation Plan about increasing the number of Indigenous health professionals in our future. And while it would take a while for us to kind of see the impacts of this, one of the components that the students do as part of their service is to ensure that they are meeting with the youth of the communities, because this has been really important for our community members, that their students, their youth, are exposed to all of the possible health careers that are out there. And then finally, the last theme about education across the spectrum is that we acknowledge that to date we haven't done a good job of teaching about the impact of colonization and the inequity in healthcare, and we're really working to ensure that we change that. And so, you know, we're continued to ensure that we teach our students about these impacts and how can we shift the story to improve health outcomes. So that's kind of that framework. And so now, if we kind of just switch to, so what does this look like? Here's a picture of three of the teams that went out this past summer. And so we have these interprofessional teams that will be placed in one of six communities, at least that's what happened this past year, and they work together within that. That dog actually wasn't officially part of that team. And so usually in May, or to date in May, we've worked to prepare the students. And each kind of year that has changed, but I think that the most recent version seems to be our favorite, and we'll continue to tweak, but it's working really well. And how it starts is that the students come together for their first orientation, and I talk to them about being a good guest, systemic racism, allyship, their power, their privilege, and all of those kinds of things. And then the second session is housed in Ngamas in Education. And so the knowledge keeper, the elder, and the other folks that work within Ngamas in Education, we have a sharing circle. And it's just this really powerful opportunity for the students to talk about their goals and what they're hoping to get out of the experience. And they also talk about their fears and what are they worried about and those kinds of things. And it's just this amazing opportunity for the women within Ngamas in Education to share with them their thoughts and advice. And you can just feel the shift in the room as the students listen to these folks. And then within June or July, depending on the community, the students go out to that community, and we'll talk more about what happens in each community because it's different in each one. And then on the final day, the students come back and have another sharing circle. And if there is another team of students out at the same time, which happens in two of the cases, the students come back together, and then they can learn from each other's experiences. And so here's actually a picture post-sharing circle for the, so these were the students who went to Norway House, Pinay Mutang, and Lake Manitoba, and we, after the sharing circle, we went to the medicine garden that's just in behind here and learned more about the medicines that are within that garden. And so the core kind of within those, what the students are learning, or at least what we started with really highlighting as the must-haves of this experience is really getting to know the health services and programs within each community. And so each community really organizes their own kind of itinerary for the students on how they might showcase the programs and services. And so it might be anything from working with the children in the community through the Jordan's principal. It could be spending time with the elders facility. It might be primary care. If there's a nursing station, maybe they're at the nursing station. Home care, foot care, addictions, mental health, you name it, kind of thing, whatever makes sense for that community, the students will do that. And they might kind of move as a full group, or maybe they'll kind of be in these little smaller pairs and switch, whatever kind of seems to make sense for the community. But kind of getting to that Denawe Maganak idea of really, you know, it's beyond just the 8 to 4 of that health center. The beauty of them being immersed within these communities is that they can get to have a really strong relationship with the land. And so the students might have opportunities to kayak, to canoe, go in a York boat. All of our communities are surrounded by a lot of water and everything. So that is a constant, just the type of boat might change. Between each of the communities. And we also, for some of our communities, there's a lot of land-based education, and so they might go out with community members like these guys did and learn about, you know, tanning hides and that kind of thing. It also might be something like going out into the woods and berry picking or medicine picking and learning about what are these medicines and foods, what is their significance to the people, how might they have been used traditionally, how are they maybe using them now, and that kind of thing. And I think one of the things that I really appreciate about this picture of these berries is that, you know, as our students are gardening alongside or berry picking alongside, it's this beautiful opportunity to really connect and to get people's stories and create that relationship and just get a different understanding of the people of the community than just seeing them when they're sick in the healthcare setting. One of the things we've noticed is that all of the students love to fish or love the experience of fishing, and this seems to be one of the common things is that when the students will come back and connect with each other, there is a little bit of a competition over who caught more fish, the biggest fish, all of that kind of stuff. They all turn into these old fishermen, all of these students. And I really thought that Kaylee was going to win this one. She's a student physiotherapist that was in Poplar River. And then I realized that her photo
was doctored. So she was disqualified. I'm so glad they took that picture. It's my favorite. The other thing is that the students will often get an opportunity to meet with the chief and the counselors of the community and learn more about the governance of that community and connect that way. And so this is a picture from Norway House Cree Nation when Dr. Christina Tia and I went up to Norway House. And so that the students, the first round of students that went to Norway House are in the front row, and then there's folks from the council from that are with us in the back row. Within two of the communities, our students have learned to make traditional ribbon skirts with the community members. And so it was really nice this past summer. One of the dental hygiene students was in a community that was just starting, was their very first kind of ribbon skirt sewing class. And she happens actually to have a lot of skills relating to sewing. And so, you know, was really able to help because you had a number of sewing machines going and one teacher, she was actually it was a really great match because she could be kind of the teacher assistant and helping with bobbins and that kind of thing. And everything. And depending on the community, there's also been a number of opportunities for our students to be involved in traditional ceremonies. And so not all of our communities are traditional ceremonies, but sometimes the ceremonies don't align well, but we've had a number of our students take part in either a pipe ceremony, a water ceremony, smudging, a sweat lodge experience. And one of the communities specifically changed their dates so that the students could help with supporting the Sundance ceremony that their community has. And that was a very, very powerful experience to learn about traditional ways of healing and practices and everything. So it was quite a powerful experience for our students. As part of this, our students do a project of some sort. For some communities, it's a bit of a burden to now come up with a project kind of thing, so we kind of offer some suggestions based on things that have worked well in other communities. So often our students will do a presentation about health careers and that kind of thing. So here's a picture of three of our students who are promoting different health professions at the community center, for they had an info days and everything, so they did a presentation to the youth. Some of our students will be involved in helping with the food security and gardening and that kind of thing. One of our communities does a lot by radio, and so the students do a radio kind of promotional radio thing is the only word that's coming to me, I'm sorry, where they talk about, you know, either it's routine or like hand washing and kind of preventing colds, or it might even be something related to diabetes. But the students, the community will give them the topic and then they'll kind of run with it. And I really love one of my favorite stories is from this community that the day that they were trying to do this, you know, the Wi-Fi was especially, or the internet was especially poor, and they're, you know, scrambling and they're all standing on different rocks trying to get internet so that they can search up and get ready for their program. So it was a really great example of kind of engaging, working with the resources that they have, and then doing something that was meaningful for the community. And it might even be things like workshops related to oral health or whatever might be important. So how many more minutes do I have? Who's my timekeeper? Two? Okay. So this last year, what this looked like was that we had nine programs that are listed there in six communities in three different time frames. And just to give you some context, that this is where Winnipeg is listed here. And all of these orange communities here, or orange arrows, are the communities that the students drive to. And the two that are green, the students fly to those communities. And so the students are either driving, and in this case, they took a canoe with them. They had the foresight to do that. Sometimes they'll fly, and so it's a little bit different than the plane that goes to Amsterdam. They do everything together. They live together and eat together. Some communities, they camp together. And all of our costs related to food, accommodations, and travel, we have funding from the RBC travel Practice Travel Initiative. I'm sorry I got that wrong. But it's a funding initiative to support practice-based activities by RBC. And so I'm just going to maybe I'll learn that I've got a number of quotes here that I don't have time to go to, but I just really think that this idea of being included in their healing practices, their just that whole community part of things is just so important for them to understand kind of people's perspectives and how they can better support healthcare and being a better healthcare provider and human being is one of the really common themes that comes out. We hear a lot about people challenging their stereotypes and their biases and of Indigenous health, and having that have a really big importance. We know that they really learn a lot about when you kind of put them in an immersive environment, learning together. The opportunities for the collaboration are amazing, and I think one of the pieces that I'll leave on this is the advice that you would give future students is that, you know, to not be afraid to try something, and you'll never know when you find something you'll love. Put yourself out there, take risks, try things outside of your comfort zone. This experience may not be one of the easiest things you will ever do, but it will be one of the most valuable things that you ever do. So I'll leave on that note.
Moni, for setting the context, and Lisa for giving us those practical experiential stories. That was fantastic. So our next presenter is come all the way from Amsterdam, and Raoul Engelbert is a professor of physiotherapy, and he's the director of research at the Amsterdam University of Applied Sciences. So the floor is yours.
Yes, yeah. And the other one. Thank you very much for the introduction. I'm just here a few hours, and I learned so much. I learned a lot about fishing, but we also fish in Amsterdam. I was asked to tell you something about our University of Applied Sciences, but why are we here? We are trying to collaborate, and I think our team wants to make one and one is three, and I think you can make one and one three here in Manitoba. So I give you some data about what we are doing in Amsterdam. And I was thinking, I give a presentation about Amsterdam, about the city, but who has been in Amsterdam before? Okay, and when you think of Amsterdam, what do you think of?
The canals.
The canals.
Bike riding.
Okay, other suggestions? So since you know a lot about Amsterdam, I won't give a presentation about the city, but about our faculty. Some facts and figures. In University of Applied Sciences, we have seven faculties, and two of them work closely together. It's the Faculty of Health and Nutrition and Sports. We have one dean, it's our dean sitting over there, two directors of research, and we have eight educations, 6,300 students and 300 lecturers. We have 17 professorships, associate professorships, and four full professors who work together with University of Amsterdam or the Free University. So we work both in our University of Applied Sciences and at the University of Amsterdam. That has a lot of benefits. A lot of candidates who would like to do their PhD, and eventually we try to raise money, and in 2018 we have 51 scientific projects. And what I would like to do, those are only facts. I give you three examples in a few minutes so you can know what we are doing with all these scientific projects. And we have a lot of professional presentations and publications. And what we do, what we try to do is, eventually we are part of a big University of Applied Sciences. And in Amsterdam, 40,000 students study in these seven faculties. And we have strong collaboration with our university hospitals, and we are closely positioned next to our university hospital. So it's our neighbor. We learn about them, but they learn about from us. So I think it's a good collaboration there, and we try to make collaborations all over the world, and here we are. So also strong collaboration with the municipality, and we have projects with elderly people in Ben Sayed and with children projects in Amsterdam. So more details. We try to focus our research in one theme. It's urban vitality. How can we make Amsterdam as vital as the urban problems as vital as possible? And eventually, we want to become from a spearhead to a center of expertise. And here you see the continuum in vitality. On one side, we have top sporters. And on the other side, we have severely injured and disabled people, for example, at the intensive care. And what can we learn from each other? How can we train them who are severely ill? How can we train them with the knowledge of top sporters? And how can all the people in Amsterdam with their vital problems, how can we help them the best we do? And how can we do it in an interprofessional way? And I told you before, we have 17 professorships. And when we start from the left one, it's the Faculty of Nutrition, Sports, and our university. They are training. They are looking, for example, at top sport, at sport activities, at moving in educations. And all those 17 professorships are focusing on all the on some parts of our university, of our urban vitality program. So we learn a lot from each other through a continuum of these questions. And I think we have an exciting program. And what we try to do is client-patient care is situated next to research and situated next to education. So all the students participate in our research. For example, we have a professor who has PhD candidates, and they have collaboration with the lecturers or these researchers, and they bring students with them. So we make, for example, a roof tile construction so that everyone can participate in this research. And eventually, we also collaborate strongly with the Faculty of Medicine, and Stephan will tell you more about it in a few minutes. And in these living labs, we try to do patient care research and education closely together. And eventually, we would like to become, from an urban vitality point of view, to a center of expertise. And not only the research is very essential, but also how do we collaborate with our staff, with our research and education, and how do we organize everything, and how do we communicate it, not only in the faculty, but also in the municipality. So research staff is situated, and data management, statistical support, helps us to make our dreams come true. And we have some money sometimes, and we try to seed the money to projects. And in our collaboration, we have also some seed money projects. So how can we make interdisciplinary projects who eventually will become bigger funding projects, not only between professions, but also with the Faculty of Medicine, but maybe also with the University of Manitoba? How can we organize it to make seed money projects together? And eventually, it will change education. And we found some money at our university and at the government in the Netherlands. And three faculties work strongly together: Faculty of Health, Faculty of Nutrition and Sports, and the Faculty of It's about digital media. It's sort of domotica, that kind of things. So when we're now doing projects on research and patient care, all these three parts should be in it. It's movement, it's nutrition, it's technology. And how can we organize all the projects in these three themes? And eventually, the research infrastructure will benefit from it. And the collaboration between those three faculties will have an offspring in the curriculum. A lot of theory, and now what we are really doing. So eventually, moving domotica and e-health and nutrition and all the projects should be situated somewhere here. At least, eventually, it should be in the middle, but we are not that far already, but we will manage. And I'll give you three examples of our projects. First of all, vulnerable children. In collaboration with pediatric rehabilitation, with the municipality and with the Safati Institute, Mirka Janssen, Magover Hartingsveld, who is sitting over there, and myself are dealing with children who have problems in moving, in nutrition, and we help them. And what can this project is called Gimmerman's Oog. It's difficult to translate in English, but it's about children who move in a school situation. They have gymnastic classes, and we found out that about 20,000 children have been measured by the teachers and by the students, and we found out that about 6,000 children have severe problems in their gross motor development. So we should do something about it. And how can we design together a tool for monitoring, but also how can we develop care? And since we know that obesity is a big problem in Amsterdam, and also not only we have about 160 ethnicities in Amsterdam living with their own problems and their own way of looking at their problems, this should be handled with care, and we are doing research together. And eventually, we think that when you play and move, your motor development will be stimulated with a lot of fun, more physical activities, decrease of weight, and increase of health. So by changing the children and their families and the professional teachers, how can you stimulate this part and eventually have healthier children in Amsterdam? A large project. Another project I would like to tell you about, vulnerable elderly. And this is also a project with Domotica Nutrition, Movement and Psychology, and 150 students participated in this project. And what did we do? The project was called Vitamin, and we do know that when you train people, you tell elderly, yeah, you should move more, but not once, twice, but you should do it more frequently. So frequency and intensity is very essential. And when you do it in a functional way, for example, when you are cleaning the house, when you're doing the dishes, that's more essential than lifting weights. So we train all these elderly in their home situation, and we give them some advices around nutrition. And we have now analyzed all the data. We have included 240 elderly in three groups, and they really moved more. They really gained, they lost some weight, but also the muscles developed better than we have thought. So sarcopenia is a big problem in the elderly, didn't occur in this group. So the combination of intense training in a functional way with a computer and also dietary counseling is effective in elderly people. And the last project is from one of our colleagues, Martijn Stuiver, and he works in the cancer hospital in Amsterdam. And he would like to design something about improving exercise coaching and exercise self-management during cancer treatment. And he sees a lot of women with breast cancer, and they follow now, based on his experience, a supervised exercise program during chemotherapy, and it can preserve their physical fitness, it can limit the fatigue and other symptoms, and increase the chance of chemotherapy completion. That's what the literature tells us. But how do you do it? And then he had a project, it's called OnconNet, and this is Amsterdam, you see here the canals, and those are the private practices, the primary care practices dealing with cancer treatment, and they're all combined. So when they treat the patients, they do it in the same way, and they have a structured way of dealing and collaboration. And what he did eventually is he made a program with the stakeholders, patients were involved, but also researchers, physiotherapists from the two university hospitals, but also students were there. And it's a melting pot, and they thought of ideas, how can you change behavior in women with breast cancer? And then they decided to make an app, and they learned from the patients, how can I follow my own journey? I want to keep track to be more aware and get more insights. And I would like to have a better overview. And what they did is they made a program of where the women participated daily. How are you feeling today? How was your experience today? How did you move? And some preliminary results tell us that it's really effective when you combine movement, nutrition, and also domotica or e-health. In summary, lecturers and students are in our faculty in a central position. We have one focus of research, primarily one focus, it's urban vitality, and we try to combine patient care, research, and education. Eventually, we want to become from an urban vitality towards a center of expertise. It's interprofessional, interfaculty research, and we are bridging the gaps, and it can only be done by chemistry and a good communication. And then, the last slide. Collaboration. I think University of Manitoba, Rady Faculty of Health Sciences, and the College of Rehabilitation Sciences, and the University of Amsterdam Applied Sciences, Faculty of Health, I think we can wake one and one as three. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Raul. That was so interesting. Thanks for bringing Amsterdam to Winnipeg. Our next presenter is Stephan Ramaeker. And Stephan is a professor, he's a physiotherapist and an educationalist, and his focus is on interprofessional education and shared decision making. At the end, we'll have hopefully about 10 minutes for questions.
Okay. First of all, I'm very pleased to be here. About 1 year after Reg visited us and talked to us on a large congress about interprofessional collaboration and interprofessional education about a year ago. And I was very enthusiastic about collaborating with Reg and seeing if we could get this any further. Now, I have a daunting task in the sense that you had two presentations, one about the educational part and one about community practice, and I have to try to combine them into one and then still stick to the 15 minutes. So I'm going to see if I'm going to manage this. But before I continue doing this, I would like to say a few words about healthcare system in the Netherlands as such, and I would like to add that I'm standing on the shoulders of many others. We are still at the beginning of developing interprofessional education in our university. We started with this in 2016 in implementing a collaborative program with all the different professions involved in the Faculty of Health. But we're still at the start. There are many things which have been done before, which I did not include, which I would call interprofessional in terms of the character they had, but really talking about it in the sense of this is focusing on the interprofessional collaboration, on interprofessional education, that is only from a recent date. Now, let me just tell you a few things about the healthcare system in the Netherlands, because it's affects the way we look at interprofessional collaboration. Now, compared to Canada, we're a very small country, densely populated. We really have to take a day out to see if we can find any rural area, because probably when we arrive at it, we already leaving it because it's so small. So it's highly populated, and some of our health problems are different than yours. For example, getting access to health care is here a huge problem and a huge demand. But in our case, we have many health facilities reasonably nearby. Now, one of the large issues in about healthcare provision in the Netherlands is related to the population. If you look at 2005 and you look at the number of people we have in each age group, then you can see that there is a big bump here where we had many children born in a similar time frame. But if you look at it 10 years later, then it starts moving. If we look at 2025, even if we look at 2035, then you can see simply from the demographics already, that we are getting into a situation where a large group of our population is over 60. In fact, even if you look here, the largest group of all ages is over 60, 65. And related to that, there are a number of issues in healthcare and healthcare provision, such as multimorbidity. We have people getting older. Of course, we want them to stay healthy, we want them to stay independent of others, independent of healthcare providers, as long as possible. That means that a number of the issues which we are related to is how are we going to deal with the complex care that all these comorbidities or multimorbidities require? How are we going to deal with having or giving each person the opportunity of staying at home as long as possible, staying independent of healthcare provision and other things as long as possible? Those are really major issues in healthcare in the Netherlands. I don't know. But this doesn't seem to be my presentation anymore. Yeah. No, this is not my presentation. Okay. The start slides are okay, but then there is something else missing here. I have it. Well, otherwise I have to do it out of my head. Okay. Besides the demographic changes and the consequences that has on healthcare, there is a second thing, and it is of course the advancement, technological advancement, which brings about different demands to healthcare providers. Healthcare in the, is getting more complex. There are more professionals involved there, and they need to collaborate some way or another. Together with that is the tendency of having an increased specialization in all kinds of areas. I remember when I graduated, about one third of all cardiac patients were still treated by internal, what we call internal medicine, and only the others were treated by cardiologists. 10 years later, most of the patients were treated by cardiologists. If we look at it now, I saw that there were about 16 subspecialisms in cardiology already, where one doesn't know exactly what the other does or what the other is able to do. So if you really have a complex cardiology problem, then you need to have several professionals, several specialists working together to solve that problem. The same takes place in professions like in physiotherapy in the Netherlands. We have about nine kind of specialisms where people tend to focus only on one particular condition or one particular patient group. So if you are dealing with multiple diseases, then it also is a result that you are seeing multiple professionals. And if they are not collaborating, if they are all doing their own thing, if the patient continuously keeps to tell the same story to another person, keeps to make sure that every professional knows what the other has been doing and things like that. So also from the side of specialization and advancement, the complexity of care is growing, and that that brings a focus to what can we do in terms of interprofessional collaboration. Then, what does our faculty do? It's somewhere in 2014 that the dean and the heads of departments decided we should work on a program where we start introducing interprofessional collaboration early in the educational programs of all professionals who are having their basic education at our faculty. So they started a project in which they said, okay, we are going to have some kind of interprofessional educational program, starting already early so that they can early get used to the fact that this is simply a normal part of your education. Now in 2016, that program really started becoming implemented. And now we have a program in which about yearly 1,800 students are involved. It's about every year they have 1 week in which they collaborate and discuss about cases, have simulations, try to discover what is the difference in the perspective of an occupational therapist from an exercise therapist. The professionals that are involved in there are exercise therapy, occupational therapy, physiotherapy, nursing, and medicine. So we collaborate in this with the School of Medicine, which is nearby to us. That program is now in its fourth year of, so every year you have this activity as part of your normal educational program. And in general, you can say that it's built up in a way in which we start first at the question, who am I? What is a physiotherapist? What is my profession? How do I look upon issues of health, healthcare, health professionals? How do I look at my patients? How do I look at the people I'm working with? And from there, in the first year of the question, who am I, is who are the others? What is an occupational therapist? What is an exercise therapist? Where does an exercise therapist differ of a physiotherapist in terms of expertise, in terms of approach to issues, approach to patient questions? So it's getting to learn each other. In the third year, we are focusing on not on the collaboration as such, if it works smoothly, but what happens, or what is a collaborative leadership? What happens in cases of dilemmas, in cases of conflict? How are we going to deal with such situations? How are we going to collaborate and bring the level of collaboration to a higher level? And in the fourth year, you're going into a student-run clinic where you work in a team and where you are responsible for the care of the patients. And I guess that resembles to what you call your wish clinics, where they are student-run and where you are supervised, but then still are responsible yourself for the care of the patients that come in. That's one part, and so far we are now, but at the same time we are developing, or in the process of developing, a broad kind of paramedic bachelor. It's still in the process of being developed, so there are a lot of things still uncertain, but the idea there would be, why start in separate schools? Can't you start in a program with all three paramedical professions together, and gradually developing or finding out perhaps occupational therapy is something which would suit me better, or physio is something which would suit me better, and from there start developing into which profession would fit me best, would fit my talents, would fit my approach, and so on. But then being exposed to having worked together already in your educational program already a lot with the other professions. Okay, then I still need, because I had selected 8 kind of projects, so I would like to, I had selected 8 kind of projects where I feel that there could be collaboration between University of Manitoba with you and us. The first one is, if we look at those student-run clinics, you can look at them in a very clinical setting, in hospitals or specialized centers and things like that. We're still developing them. We still are quite uncertain about all kinds of issues related to optimal guidance, to optimal preparation of students for this. How do we collaborate? How do we make sure that the clinicians feel comfortable about issues like safety and things like that? How are we going to assess them? Are we going to assess them as a team, or are we going to assess them as individuals in there? So there are quite a number of issues which we have to deal with. And we are not only focusing this from the point of view of education itself, but we also want to study this. We also want to do research about, okay, the different systems, because there's quite a number of things which are already known and which we try to use in the primary design, but then we still don't know whether that really works out in the complete mixture. A second thing is, which is a similar kind of group, is related to how does it work in primary healthcare? We have a primary healthcare system, and we have, in fact, if we look at most of our students from the paramedic professions, they go into primary healthcare. And how is collaboration there? How can we have their student-run clinics in which all professions are related into there? And how is collaboration taking place there? Because it requires something different. For example, different professions, people working at the homes of, for example, the elderly as the target group. And how is collaboration then given place? And questions are there, for example, is it about interprofessional or is it about transprofessional collaboration? Is it the case that perhaps the occupational therapist also does some of the things or has some of the skills and the knowledge of the physical therapist so that you don't need two people going to the homes of these, but that there is one person who's going there as the main person in charge of the treatment, things like that. A third project coming up is, what are actually the key competencies of interprofessional collaboration? Now, of course, there's a lot written, there is already a lot of research, but still we feel that we're not sure what is the difference between collaborating of profession in terms of multi-professional collaboration and interprofessional collaboration. What makes really multi-professional collaboration interprofessional? When is it interprofessional? How can we know that? We have a PhD program working on that kind of issues. What defines the interprofessional really in terms of practical skills, and how can we see that? Another one, patient profiles in interprofessional decision making. If you look at interprofessional collaboration, is it working people together or is they really deciding together? And then who is going to decide on the basis of what? And could it be that we use patient profiles in such a way that they help determining whether it should be treated by the one or the other, or whether it should be treated interprofessional or not? And could we use modern technologies to help us in using these kind of patient profiles? This is only half. I have. Then there is a new project which we will be starting, and I took particularly reasonably recent ongoing project or project which are new. It's about ethical issues related to interprofessional. Who is dealing with the ethical questions? How are you going to be dealing with this in a team? Who is deciding upon which things? Which typical ethical issues are coming up? we can think of a number, but we really would like to research them as well and see if there are particular methods which we could use to better equip our students with the tools that they need to be able to deal with this kind of situation in interprofessional teams. Another one is we use team-based learning methodology. I don't know if you know that, in the sense of the typical TBL approach as one defined approach. We use that, and we use it to see whether it can help in decision-making in teams. And we would like to know if we keep on using this in a particular way, if we use it with a particular design characteristics, whether that helps students in the process of decision-making in teams. There are more, but I've picked a number of this kind of project where I feel, well, we still have to start and we can still collaborate with you and see which one would be interesting for you as well. Or perhaps we can say, okay, you are doing certain things which we could incorporate in our studies, in our designs. Yeah? My apologies that it must be my own mistake that.
Well, you know what? We'll try to get your, we'll get your slides out if that's okay.
Yeah.
And sorry to cut you off, but we will get the slides to everybody if that's okay with our presenters. I can certainly see from our day one of our first morning of our collaboration, there's clearly a lot of shared visions, a shared ideas, and a year ago is when Reg was in Amsterdam. I was just looking at the calendar, and that's when he really realized the shared institutional vision for internationalization, for interprofessional collaboration, and all the themes working in and with communities and digital health technology. So tomorrow, our next session, our next Illuminate, is going to be on working in and with communities. And on Friday, it will be on digital health technology. But our guests are here all week, and there'll be lots of opportunities to exchange ideas, to set up meetings with a little bit of flexibility and schedules. So please don't hesitate to reach out to our colleagues and for our Amsterdam colleagues to reach out to our faculty here in Winnipeg. So thank you very much for coming. Looking forward to seeing you tomorrow and during the week. Thank you. Probably take time for one question. Does anybody have one question before we wrap? Or you'll save your questions for one-to-one. Oh, Nadine has one or comment. Yeah, and there we have working session today. In the program book, you'll see working sessions. We have a working session today from 2 to 4 related to interprofessional collaboration. Another lunch/working session, brown bag lunch tomorrow, and then another one on Friday. We will be sending out the location actually we've established for tomorrow's is going to be room 1110. So that's the meeting room that you're all very familiar with. So please join us when you can. And if you can't, then let us know. We can try to set up some one-to-one meetings. Thank you very much for coming.